me tell you how educative it has been to hear Professor Grover and Kiran Kumarji on this occasion. There are some things which there are things which I knew. There are many things which I didn't know. And one of the things which was interesting was to say that whenever we talk of Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, it never sounds like we are talking history. It looks like we are talking current. And that's so relevant to it, because what he said, what he did, the projects he was excited about are all basically current projects. They're things which are active, people have taken them forward, and how dynamically the whole thing has evolved. I will talk about some of the same points, but with a slightly different perspective. Meena, can I have the next slide, please? He made a talk in 1970 where he says the Global Earth Resources Survey he was talking about will hopefully help humankind realize that there is one world and that its resources are to be used wisely for the benefit of all humankind. Now, this is a very powerful environmental statement. It is a statement which came, if you remember, in at a time when the environment consciousness was really in its infancy. 68, when we saw the first Earthrise photograph, it made people realize, but this is what he was talking about. Next, please. So this comment, which many of you might have heard, that he really saw the connection between science and development. This is a quote from him: the development of a nation is intimately linked with understanding the application of science and technology by its people. He's not only talking about providing science to people, but having people understand science. You need to, the population as a whole needs to understand it, and people can understand it sometimes even without being necessarily literate. Kiran Kumarji was talking about how fishermen, who may not be literate in the reading writing sense, will also appreciate it. Vikram Bhai in 68 was a member of the Scientific Advisory Committee of the UN. This was a small group of about 6 or 7 people, and that is the time when the first proposal for the first environmental conference actually came up. It was a conference on the human environment, which was later held in 72 in Stockholm. But it was the first time this proposal, and he writes at that time in a talk at Trombay, he talks about how the United Nations was still considering these environmental issues, and they found that most people who were talking about it saw these issues as being issues of the developed world. And India was largely silent. He comes back to India at that time, and with the COST, which is the Committee on Science and Technology of the Cabinet, of which he was a member, he discusses this and says that India must play a very important role in bringing environment and development together. So it was not just development we are talking about, but we were talking about environment and development together. And this was really the beginning of the modern environment movement. He passed away, but in 72 was when the Stockholm conference was held. And by that time, India was so much into it. Professor Ganguly was, I think, the chair of the committee which he formed to look at this issue from atomic energy. And Indira Gandhi became the first and only prime minister, head of government, to visit Stockholm for this conference, giving the opening speech where she talks that on the one hand, rich are talking about continuing poverty. On the other hand, they warn us against their own methods. We do not wish to impoverish the environment any further, and yet we cannot for a moment forget the grim poverty of large number of people, and not poverty and need the greatest polluters. So here is the whole issue of, is it a conflict or is it not? The conflict of being modern and the conflict of lifting our things. It was in 92, which was already mentioned by one of the speakers, that really this is 20 years after the Stockholm conference, when the first major environmental conference comes together in 92. I was part of the Indian delegation at that time. It was led by Narasimha Rao, was our prime minister at that time. And at that, we got the opportunity, of writing the India report. And I'm just quoting one line from it, and I'm quoting it because it comes very much after what one has learned from Dr. Sarabhai. The real challenge of development is not how to get there, but how not to. In other words, how not to be just imitative. Kiran Kamarji mentioned today how India's space program has developed in a way which has reached goals, but has not just followed. It has taken new. And this is where the whole concept, which was developed by the earlier speakers on leapfrogging, which was very, very close to Dr. Sarabhai. This particular chart, which I show, talks about backwardness or poverty or underdeveloped at the bottom of that chart and development at the top. And on the left-hand side, we have unsustainability, and on the right-hand side, we have a sustainable situation. And most countries go from backwardness and poverty, in which environmentally they might be sustainable, and they go towards a paradigm which is current, heavy use of fossil fuel, heavy consumption, huge amount of waste, and finally unsustainable. And in fact, if everyone were to follow that, the globe would collapse even straight away. And those countries are moving towards a more sustainable thing. The question comes as to where should we go? Do we first imitate and follow that path and then be told to change? Or can we go straight there? And that's how I see the whole concept of leapfrog, which he said, that we leapfrog unsustainability. We leapfrog just the post-industrial thing. We learn from others, but don't imitate. And there's a difference between learn and imitate. And he talks about in that quote, there is a totality about the process of development. Now, this is another very important concept of talking about development process, not in silos. You cannot look at agriculture as one area and poverty as another and industrialization as a third and other things not connected. They are, in fact, highly connected. And then, of course, he connects the space program and atomic energy programs to the very goals of the nation. It was not a separate program done by scientists alone, but scientists who are concerned and were very much part of India's development, and as we see this increasingly happening. Next one, please. So that whole journey, which started in 92, started in 72 and then 92, finally led up in 2015 to the Sustainable Development Goals. And so today, when we define or when we talk about development, I think we need to talk about not just any development, but we talk about development in the context of the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals. We were fortunate to work closely with the government of India in working with the United Nations in helping get India's position across. As many of you probably know, there are 17 goals. It goes from poverty to hunger to health, all the way to urbanization, energy, climate change, biodiversity, infrastructure, partnerships, and this variety of goals. And then there are 169 targets with that. So I thought that, suppose this is something we are working on, and I thought that for today's talk, let me look at Dr. Sarabhai's statements from this perspective. Let me look at it from the perspective of the SDGs, and how does that go? So the first thing was SDGs on poverty and hunger and things, and the Krishi Darshan program, which was started. There was a nice little piece which Padmanabh Joshi just sent me hours before this talk, where he quotes Dr. M.S. Swaminathan. And Swaminathan says that he and Dr. Sarabhai were going around, and they came to a field and they were looking at these new experiments in agriculture. And Dr. Sarabhai says, look, this has to go to everyone immediately. So it sounded, Dr. Swaminathan says, it sounded like something which we'll do in the future. He goes back to Delhi, and that next day, or that same day, goes to the Prime Minister and says, look, we've got this fantastic technology in agriculture. We need to do it. And within a month or two, the Krishi Darshan program is born. That was the speed. That was the speed of seeing something, seeing an opportunity, seeing how technology could assist it, and then taking it forward. Next one. And then, as was again mentioned just now, this is from the introduction to his book, which Dr. Kamala Chowdhury wrote. she writes, Vikram Sarabhai had a restless and always seeking new ways, new institutional arrangements. Something which Mr. Ravi Grover very rightly said right at the beginning of his talk, that to see that if you want to achieve something, what type of organization do you do? What type of growth do you do? What type of people do you need? It was done in parallel, but that thinking was almost as important as the science itself. New combination of skills and competencies to deal with the many problems in which he was involved. And then it says with Swaminathan at that time, the director of IARI, they planned the Nuclear Center for Agriculture, a joint venture which would bring together competencies of nuclear scientists and agricultural scientists and the resource support of ICAR and DAE. So this ability to link different, seemingly different disciplines for the purpose of India's development. Next one. Now, remote sensing, I'm not going to talk much about it. I think Kiran Kumarji has given us some beautiful examples of remote sensing. He spoke about remote sensing and very rightly said it is concerned with the direct application of everything connected with space technology for the betterment of man, particularly in the developing nations. And then that particular talk goes on to talk about oceanography, geology and mineral resources, hydrology, geography and cartography, agriculture, and many more today, fisheries, forest conservation. There are certain things which are possible today. And what was very nicely was shown through the microwaves that even during monsoon, you are able to keep this. So all of this required his interest in saying that the scientific temper, the understanding of science should really be among people as a whole. I myself was doing natural science. I was doing theoretical physics and mathematics when I went to Cambridge. And I had, and when I left India, I was thinking that was what it was most exciting I would like to do. It was there that I saw a series of articles on reporting India negatively, which bothered me. But then came the Bihar drought in, I think, 67. And I came back, asked my father, can I go and spend time? I spent a month there. And I said, I can't see myself in India not being involved in these problems. And I would like to really get involved in the development field. And there he tells me that he says, you finish your degree in physics or basic sciences because it gives you the sort of grounding. It is not necessary that you only do physics afterwards as research, but it is the foundation of understanding the modern world, foundation of certain thinking. And therefore, his whole improvement, so it went into the group of improvement of science education, GISE, which later on became the Community Science Center. After my father, it was renamed the Vikram A. Sarabhai Community Science Center. And I'm very proud to say that we could ask Shri Kasturi Ranganji to chair it and lead it now, and which is marvelous. Even your few words when you say it takes us further. Today, we have already spoken about the site experiment. The goal of the SDGs is on education, quality education. Now, he saw at that time that how do I reach education even to villages which have no roads, no other connectivity? And can we, this is a typical leapfrogging example, can we go and reach out and provide some of the best education to people anywhere in India? Now, that goal, which was the site experiment, and a lot has happened since then, but it is no truer than today. I was just thinking that if we today really put ourselves together and say that once and for all, we want no child left behind in India, no child who cannot get education, whether they have access to a school or not, as long as we can afford to give them maybe a smartphone, which looking at the overall goals of India is really not all that much. And if we can really give that, and I remember him when the site experiment was discussing, they said that because the ground segment is so much, we want the dish antenna, the chicken mesh antenna, to be really low cost. So let us make the satellite more powerful, so that the ground segment, which is multiplied by so much, is less. So if you can really have a powerful transmission of ideas and education and concepts and reach out, this is possible. It's already happening now because of COVID. So many schools are having to do this. And that experiment was not just for education. It went for, it deals with health, it deals with gender issues, it deals with the whole concept of economic growth. So once you have a medium like that, you're not only dealing with education. Now we do know, for instance, that the population problem, population issue is so sensitive that we have not been able to even mention it in the SDGs. The world population is growing. Today, every 13 years, we add another billion people to this planet. What used to take 130 years now takes 13 years. Now, at that rate, no amount of development is going to really help us. But the interesting thing is that there is enough research which says that if all people are educated, and especially women, then the population is a consequence of it. People can then control their bodies, they know what to do, and the population comes down like it is in Kerala, like it is in, to some extent, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu and others, wherever you've been able to put it. Now, this dream is an opportunity today. Today, we can really say that just like we took up major campaigns, we said, let us make India defecation free, let us make India plastic free is what we're trying in 2 years. Can we not say that there will be no child in this country or in the world for that matter, who is educated, and some of the other problems get solved on their own. Next one, please. Now, again, Mr. Grover spoke a lot about this. I don't want to say about it, but Dr. Sarabhai at that time was talking more in terms of coal and the distance of traveling and how to make nuclear power as a viable option. Globally, because of some of the safety issues and some of the questions, one of the questions which was asked to Mr. Grover earlier about nuclear waste, it is in fact a major solution to the whole carbon and to climate change and everything else. The only reason some countries are not considering it is because of not having solved yet the problem of safety and people's perception of nuclear power. And I think if India again takes a leadership in safely doing this, it could really change. This is something from an executive who worked with him in a company called Systronix. He writes, one quality that I liked in Vikram Bhai and that I've tried to copy is that I was never keen on filling up vacancies. Whenever he would find someone interesting, he would hire them. He made organizations around people and not people around organizations. Now, this is something which you need to do a little bit of both, no doubt. But the amount of times I've seen and heard stories and known about it where he might have hired someone for something and then it changed. And of course, in this photo, you see Abdul Kalamji with Vikram Bhai. And he himself writes how he was working on maybe the third stage of the rocket, while he said, how can I work on that with the first and second? And I think Vikram tells him that, look, no, you should continue doing what you are best at. And this whole ability of nobody as a result of it looking at it as a job, in whichever organization he's worked and people I've met, will continuously say it was never a job. It was never a job. We were with him in that mission. Which was there. It was infectious. The mission was infectious. And we became part of that. Next one. Infrastructure, we already discussed. This is a photo with Mr. Bhavsar. And I think Upendra Bhai. The whole, not only the space program, but electronics, as again was mentioned, 35 institutions of social change. And my colleague Padmanab has a whole list of small and large institutions, but today some new are added in management, in science, in atomic energy and textile, in education, communication. Did that mean that his interests were scattered? And in fact, it was not scattered. He saw it as a single mission in some ways, the development of this communication of science to it. So even in a very traditional business like textile, when he comes back from studying and he sees his family in textile, he says that, look, there's no R&D here. How about doing research? And today that same material is doing things on fabric which has nothing to do with wearing clothes. It has got a fabric which can withstand a different type of thing. They're even thinking of fabric which can perhaps make an automobile body. So the whole idea of dreaming and coming out with new applications, but all the time in your mind is, how do I apply science and technology to the frontiers of what needs to be done? Next one. Now, peace. One of the important goals which is mentioned in the SDGs is that without peace and justice and institutions which support this, you really can't move forward. Today, you see how much is lost when you don't have peace. If there are countries which are dogged by war. He was a part of the Pugwash group. This is a photo of Pugwash 13 in Czechoslovakia. But the one before that, Pugwash 12, I believe, in 63 was held in Jaipur. And he was very much instrumental in organizing that. But very interested in the peaceful uses of this and initiated at that time the Indian Pugwash committee for this. And looking at problems of disarmament and how you make the world safer. He was a very strong advocate of the peaceful use of nuclear energy, but also argued against signing the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. That option that India should have, to have an essentially unjust imposition put on you by countries which had the nuclear power, that we can have them, but you can't because you are not responsible, was something which was completely unacceptable. And therefore, there's a difference between knowing how to and finding the right moment when you do it. I think, Kasturi Gandhi, you talked about this fascinating thing from a radio about manned space flights and quoted him to saying that, yes, human spirit is such that at some stage we will push forward. But maybe at the starting, that's not what we want to do. At the starting, we'll focus on others, but many people misinterpret, does he not want to do it? It was not that he didn't want to do it. He was talking about prioritization, and he understands that there is something which is done for the emotion of people. People want to go there. People want to reach different heights, and that is as important as the science. So not signing an unjust treaty. The question is not whether we want to make it or not. The question is, we do not want to get into something which puts us in the second category of nuclear nations. And I think this was very, very important to him. Next one. In these partnerships, the space program itself, you can see how much of a partnership it was. It was a partnership, of course, Atomic Energy, PRL, the government of Kerala at the national level, but with COSPAR, with NASA, with CNES. There was a whole set of partners with the Soviet Union, West Germany. I mean, the whole concept of partnership, and I'm going to come to later how he saw those partnerships. But the fact of partnership, which is one of the goals, incidentally, of Sustainable Goal 17 on partnership. And the site itself was again a partnership. There was collaboration on the fast breeder reactor and Tulpakkam, which already has been spoken of. Next one. IIM. Again, the whole concept of leapfrogging, you can, of course, you have to take the right decision. Do you want to start from scratch or do you want to start where it was? He did see in this case that the Harvard Business School had already perfected, if you like, a certain case study method and others. So it was done as a collaborative thing. But his collaborations were never where we were the second part of the collaborator. There was a concept of being equal in partnerships, equal in collaboration, and the ability to adapt and Indianize anything which we got and we took. So it was not imitative. And I think there's a difference. There are some collaborations where you take something and just simply follow. As an industrialist, he believes that if industry had to grow and develop at a rapid pace, a technical collaboration with advanced nation was required. And in pharmaceuticals, he at that time collaborated with three of the top 10 companies to see that the Sarabhai Chemicals, which he formed, reached the stage which was among the top pharma company, top two pharma companies of India for almost 25, 30 years. And this happened because modern medicines could come here. Modern research-based medicines could come here. Today, I think the company which my son Mohal is looking at just now has tried to bring in a new testing for COVID. And one realizes how resistance there is to any new methodology, which might be better, simpler, but how do we believe in science or do we just imitate? Arvi at Pune, the Earth Station, was a very important example where it had already been decided that it would be made elsewhere. The contract, I believe, was already given. And he goes to the Prime Minister and says, look, I think we can build it. Why are you doing this? It's a very interesting story how the Indian government says, sorry, we can't change it. The contract is already given. Unless, of course, they go and say that it should not, they cannot do it or some such reason. And I think Vikrami goes and talks to potentially the competitor who got the contract and gets this change. And then, of course, we build it ourselves. It is a little case study in its own right. And the story needs to be properly documented and said. One should ensure that nationals of the country at the operative level of the program are sufficiently committed and are willing to stretch themselves to the fullest before asking for help. So this is that point I was making, that when he talks about collaboration, it is after you stretched yourself and done all you can. And look at this iconic photograph of that payload being taken on a bicycle, that we were not dependent on people. We went ahead and we did wonderful things. This is a quote from Mr. Aramudan's biography, which I just happened to see. He writes that Dr. Vikram Sarabhai floated the idea of a space program when rocketry and space technology was unknown in India. I was in a comfortable and prestigious central government scientific position in the Department of Atomic Energy, he says. Despite the friendly warnings from friends about leaving a prestigious job for something still at a nascent stage, Aramudan accepted and joined. So he was saying how you recruit those people. Atomic energy was an established, ongoing thing. The space was a fledgling in that, and it was a chance. But how that initial team got together, and that same spirit I find in new people, when we meet some young people, Mr. Kasturi Rangan, when you meet young people who are joining ISRO, you are seeing the same dynamic, same sort of fascination with which they are joining. And that is wonderful. Next one. This story, to some extent, has been told by Kasturi Rangan, by Kiran Kumarji. But it's a story worth telling again and again, that we often, for national causes, for a very good reason, we ride rough over people. We can do some of these things. You can do through passing a law, but it's so important to take people with you. And this is really a remarkable example of how people who have a church are willing to, on their own. I think Reverend Pereira asked Sarabhai to come on the Sunday morning and talk to the parish, and he said that if the parish, everyone says yes, only then we will do it. And he goes there and talks to them and convinces them, and they say yes. And today there is a wonderful museum in that building. The building is still there. I had the opportunity to see it. But it shows much more than it shows the methodology. How do you do things? Which is very important. Next one. So when he talks about self-sufficiency and collaboration, he again, we come back to this, that one should ensure that nationals of the country at the operative level of the program, again that point, are sufficiently committed and willing to stretch themselves to the fullest before asking for outside help. So I think these contradictions, was he for going to space or not? Was he for having a bomb or not? Was he for collaboration or not? It is not either or in his case. It is the moment to select when. When is it right to collaborate? How do you collaborate? How do you network? How do you keep nationalism high and at the same time be a global citizen? These are not contradictions. These are facets of our personality. There are different multiple identities which we all have. And I think he was brilliant in the way he could bring these things together and not take dogmatic views, and as was spoken by one of some of my earlier speakers, being able to win over people. It was not only the people in Tumba, but he had to win over a lot of people in Delhi, I'm sure, in those initial days. And as I'm sure every chair of Department of Space or Atomic Energy has to do, that you have to be convinced, you have to continuously convince people who don't necessarily understand your science. And how do you gain that support? Because after all, we are in a democracy and we do this. So thank you very much for this. I remember the days when I got the opportunity of learning from him. This is a photo with me, Mr. Kasturiranga.
Yeah,
floor at Chidambaram and looking at the books on science. Thank you.